Hi guys, welcome to African Explorer Magazine. My name is Wambongo Kamodho. Last week we talked about astronomy. Today we are talking about nuclear. And in studio today, we have Madam Sally. Please introduce yourselves and also your background.
My name is Sally Gatey. I'm a nuclear scientist. I've done masters in nuclear science. A bit of my background is that my first degree was in geology, and I've worked in industry for a couple of years before doing my master's program, working with international bodies like AUCFA, just representing STEM, and just trying to do a bit of science outreach and communication.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Now, how did you end up doing a master's in nuclear? And is it hard for the local Kenyan who's watching? Is it hard to get a master's in nuclear science?
I wouldn't say it's hard, but there's always challenging courses. It's a challenging course, but it's never hard. Obviously, if you're determined and if you're really good in sciences, I think it's something that people can do.
Yeah. So in terms of your background, you talked about a little bit in geology. Have you ever worked professionally in geology? And what kind of work are you doing currently?
Yes, after my first degree, I worked with an international exploration company, which is called Barrick Gold. And I worked there for a couple of years doing exploration of gold in Kakamega. So yes.
The Canadian company?
Yes, Canadian? It's a bit of a mix of European countries.
Yeah.
And I worked there and got some experience, maybe 3 years experience. Then I worked with another astronomy company, an international company also, as head of science, communication and outreach. Mm-hmm. So, yes.
So you're good at communicating complex stuff?
Yes, especially science communication.
Yeah. So where, in terms of 1 to 5, where is Kenya when it comes to nuclear?
Five
being like proper nuclear country, etc. One being like zilch. We don't know anything to do with nuclear.
Wow, that's a good question. There are three types of grade countries in terms of three.
Yeah.
So one would be countries that are already having nuclear power plants.
Yeah.
Two would be countries that are preparing or just building infrastructure in preparation for a nuclear power plant. Mm. And now three would be countries that maybe are gearing towards it. It's an idea, but not yet there.
Mm-hmm.
Four would be countries that don't want nuclear power.
Okay.
So we are, I'd say number two. So we are preparing for a nuclear power plant, but a couple of years maybe to get there.
What's happening in 2023?
We had a plan to have a working nuclear power plant by 2023.
Mm-hmm.
I think there have been a bit of delays with bureaucracies, but mm-hmm. I believe because the plans are underway, we've already started planning, building infrastructure. I think 2023 will start seeing a bit of development in the nuclear industry.
Mm-hmm.
So NUPEA is the main body which is doing development and promotion of a nuclear power plant, making sure we're doing research, outreach and all that, capacity building, policies, making sure we'll be ready.
Mm-hmm.
So where we are in terms of that is hard to judge. But we've already started on infrastructure, on collaborations with other countries in terms of where do we get our engineering parts from, training. We've already been trained, so we are good with capacity building. And obviously civic education. So mm-hmm. going to the ground and trying to teach people or expose people to what really nuclear is all about.
Yeah, and let's talk a little bit about the bureaucracy. Like, what kind of hindrances are you seeing? And then, because we also need to understand, the Western powers, etc., do we work with Russia? Do we work with the UK, US?
When it comes to deciding which country to work with, obviously, it has to do with your relations,
mm-hmm.
Their policies, our policies, negotiations, the pricing.
Mm-hmm.
Who will train our people? Are they willing to train us? Do we go there for training? So a lot of discussions along these lines are still underway.
Mm-hmm.
So And these are the things we are calling now bureaucracies. So, so deciding exactly who to work with will determine how fast the nuclear facility will start running and who will run it and just how to relate these two countries. Because if you're using someone's reactor, you relate closely with them.
Is it that we can't build our own design and build our own reactors?
We can.
Yeah.
But customizing a design would take time, and it's the time we don't have. This is, we are talking of time of a couple of years, many years, maybe 10 to 15, 20 years to customize a design.
And test this.
Yes, because you have to do tests and make sure it's safe and secure and all these engineering tests. However, the current designs, the generation 3s and 4s currently operating are already tested. We also talk of experience. How experienced is the reactor? How experienced are people trained on a particular reactor? So we need this experience because you can't just start your own thing and expect to be experienced. You have to keep training people again and again. So using something that has been used before and people have seen it safe and have done all the background checks and everything would be easier for a country that is beginning. And maybe in future, yes, we can even start trying to build our own as we use and opt to use other people's reactors.
Like, so for any young Kenyan watching us, why the need to study a course like nuclear science in Kenya? Because that's the first question that came to mind before I started researching on who do I interview about nuclear science. Because how I actually got to this subject was I saw that Nairobi University offers a course in nuclear science. And the next question came, but we don't have nuclear reactors or nuclear energy, etc. Is it X-rays, something? Yeah. So why the need to for young Kenyans, and especially those guys who are interested in STEM, to study something like nuclear science?
I'd say yes. Some of the career opportunities in nuclear are medical fields, because every time you take an X-ray or you go for an X-ray or UV or whatever you're using in terms of radiation, anywhere they use radiation technology, it's an opportunity for a nuclear scientist to work.
Yes.
Because we are able to interpret.
Yes.
Yeah. So a medical physicist needs nuclear science.
Okay.
And so, yes, the medical industry is one of those places. But most of the people doing this will be assimilated by a nuclear power plant, which needs a lot of people.
Skill.
In terms of STEM. So the backgrounds should be different because of the kind of work that is required. So engineering, a lot of mathematics, a lot of science, like just generally chemistry, physics, geology. And so, yes, I think most of the people studying nuclear science would want to do particularly nuclear energy and just focus on how to build a working and operating a nuclear power plant. Yeah.
Yeah, we talked a little bit about astronomy also and how does it nuclear science and astronomy, like, I think there are some strings attached, like how do they combine, you know? Why is it connected to astronomy, and why the need to study astronomy? It's something that we discussed last time, but with Mr. Wanyoike, before he introduced me to you, and you talked about the sun being like a good example of how nuclear works. Just explain it to the layman on how it works and why they need to study stars for us to understand better the nuclear energy.
What is happening with the sun is that there's a lot of energy coming from the sun. Obviously, the sun helps us to survive. So growing plants and all that is because of the sun, the radiation that's coming from the sun. But really what is happening is like chemical reactions. So there's a lot of fusion, we call it fusion, where very fast moving atoms are colliding at a very high speed. And this high speed causes a lot of energy to be produced in the process. So, and this kind of reaction is what is causing it to produce light waves and heat waves.
Mm-hmm.
So we are going to do the same with a nuclear facility, also doing the same. So, but it will be artificial now, not just a natural process.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going now to take a neutron. A neutron is just a small part, a subatomic particle, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And then make sure it hits a big mass of an atom, so mm-hmm. a bigger atom. Mostly we use uranium, plutonium, thorium, which is radioactive. A radioactive atom would be an isotope of an atom, which mm-hmm. is unstable. Something that's unstable is either missing an electron or feels or a neutron. It's just unstable. It's not a stable atom wouldn't react very well. So we use unstable atoms.
So something like iron can't is already stable.
Yes.
Or lead is already stable.
Yes, and they are more, very stable. So those are things that you'll find in the ground, on the soil. So such things would not be optimum.
Mm-hmm.
So we use uranium, and not just the uranium isotope that is stable, but uranium isotope that is unstable, which is uranium-235.
Mm-hmm.
We exploit the instability by giving it a neutron to make it stable. In the process, we will make it fragment, so it separates. The neutron will hit it, and then it separates and creates more neutrons.
Mm-hmm.
So two particles and lighter particles. So it's uranium is very heavy,
mm-hmm.
so it will present itself in two particles, fragments, and a neutron particle. These other neutron will also bombard with the two particles.
And breaks.
Yes.
Yeah.
Again, breaking and breaking and breaking. This is a fission reaction. So this again will cause a lot of heat. Because
mm-hmm.
fast moving particles just...
It's like vibration.
Good.
And the heat is actually vibration.
Good.
Yeah. So another question is the difference between fission and fusion.
Yes.
When we were talking, why we already have things like Tomahawk guys that do more research on that.
Yeah. What is common and nuclear power plants mostly use fission, what I've talked about,
mm-hmm.
Where it's a big element being separated
mm-hmm.
to make smaller, more stable elements. So, and then now you exploit the heat from there.
Mm-hmm.
What is happening in the sun is fusion.
Mm.
So light elements like hydrogen, very light element, would be bombarding, like joining together
because
to form
the pressure.
To form a heavier element.
Mm. Helium now.
Yes.
Okay.
And now helium, again, two heliums will combine to form a heavier element.
Mm.
And the same process continues until one day the sun will die because it will be so heavy because now the compaction of the heavier elements because of the whole process over billions of years. So we won't be alive. But this kind of a fusion reaction cannot really is people think it's not viable when it comes to running a nuclear power plant because it is expensive to accelerate. Because when it comes to fission, what we use generally for a nuclear power plant, we use a very slow neutron.
Mm-hmm.
To just heat a uranium particle, right? But when it comes to a fusion reaction, what is happening in the sun, the neutron or whatever particle you are accelerating must be at a very, very high speed.
Mm-hmm.
So to attain such kinds of speeds is very expensive, let me just say it. So these kinds of speeds are hard to attain.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a lot of experiment. Construction, the infrastructures, the temperatures, good.
Mm-hmm.
So it becomes expensive in the long run to do a fusion reactor rather than a fission reactor. However, people are still researching on the same, and maybe in future we may have a working nuclear power plant using fusion.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Why using nuclear power? Is it clean? Is it environmentally friendly energy? Let's talk a little bit about that and the kind of concerns that come up when you mention nuclear energy.
Okay.
Compared to the rest of like the coal, the geothermals, etc.
Yes, nuclear energy is clean energy. The kinds of energy that we are getting from nuclear, the power is so much compared to hydro or whatever.
Hmm.
It would feed quite a large amount in the grid, and that would run industries, real industries, big industries like you know, steel industries. Yeah. All these industries need a lot of power. Nuclear would be the answer because we can do it. And nuclear only needs raw materials, which is uranium. Mm-hmm. It's accessible. So when you're dealing with energy, you have to see what you have and what you can use as a country. So I think nuclear is an option for us. And again, as I said, it's clean. So people are not afraid that if the reactor is built near your home, mm-hmm. like you're exposed to some impact in terms of environment. No. So those are the positives. And energy will be cheaper. You know, currently in your home, probably you pay for electricity. How much? Maybe a month, depending
a lot.
On. Yeah. And when it comes to nuclear, talking of what is happening in most of the countries in Europe, nuclear is cheaper. Like out of 10 countries, maybe in 8, nuclear is cheaper than all the other sources of energy. Mm-hmm. So you're talking of very cheap costs, maybe 100 rather than 500 or 400 shillings a month. Mm-hmm. So that shows you that nuclear is a good option mm-hmm. because of the types of costs for an ordinary Kenyan who may not even understand what is really happening. But to them, it will benefit them in terms of the cost.
Let's talk about the Kenyan bureaucracy. Yeah.
Yeah.
And how it's going to impact. And also look at Kenya being like ranked one of the most corrupt countries in the universe.
Okay.
Like how will it affect the advancements into nuclear? And you being in that space, have you seen any issues coming up a lot?
Yes, those are some of the negatives. Obviously, there's so much going on in terms of nuclear safety, nuclear security safeguards.
Mm-hmm.
Why the International Atomic Agency deals a lot with this is because when a reactor is in a country, the country must ensure that anything that is radioactive, we call them just radioactive waste, is handled carefully
mm-hmm.
because obviously this waste can be used to make atomic weapons. And this has happened before. It's not like something that we haven't seen or experienced. So for me, I'll say we practice what we call a nuclear culture.
Mm-hmm.
So Kenya might be corrupt, but as a nuclear body, you have to be integral. You must make sure that
the commandments you follow.
Yes. It's like law. You can't make mistakes. Mm-hmm. You can't be complicit when it comes to handling nuclear waste, when it comes to transporting a source. For example, if I'm in charge of transporting a source, currently the body in charge of safety regulations would be Kendra.
Mm-hmm.
And so they ensure that I transport that source and I get to the place I'm going with the source. The source is well protected and stored
mm-hmm.
and it's used the right way. And if there's any waste from a reactor, for example, in a couple of years, that waste is deposited the right places, and just making sure that, you know, you're accountable. So yeah, that will cost us because it's about ethics and integrity. So,
So just explain it in layman's on how to you heat that water. It is how you get the uranium, where you get it from, and then and especially you talked about generation 4. Let's not talk about the old school stuff. Let's look at the future.
Okay, so the generation 4 reactor is one of the newest reactors that now we are having. So it's better in terms of safety. It uses or utilizes different raw materials like thorium and uranium. What happens when you want to operate a nuclear reactor? You go and mine uranium or thorium or whatever you want to use in terms
from
of
Congo,
raw material.
Yeah. Most of it comes from Congo.
yeah, in Africa.
Yeah.
There's quite there's a lot of
deposit,
reserve when it comes to that. Once you get your yellow, we call it yellow cake. You take it to the lab, or now what we are calling the reactor. It's a whole facility that has a lot of things going on. And then you turn it chemically into an oxide
mm-hmm.
because you want it to be able to dissolve into water.
Mm.
So these are just chemical reactions. Then you are able to separate. I told you that, for example, for uranium, it has two isotopes.
Yeah.
one is stable and one is unstable. We want the unstable one.
Mm.
So you separate uranium-238 with uranium-235 or from uranium-235. This whole process is very expensive. Now, this is where the costs start increasing because it's very hard to do the separation. Uranium-235 is like 0.7% of the whole thing, and that's what you need. Then you take this 0.7%, place it in a reactor. It's highly radioactive. You must handle it with care, even the whole process.
That's where the corruption must stop, right there.
Yes. So when it's put in now in a reactor, now you bring in the neutron, the slow neutron. And then now you bring them together. And now the whole process now takes charge. Now it becomes a natural process where this heats this and it keeps separating. Then now this heat is directed into where the water is, to the coolant, so specifically. And then it heats the coolant, whichever the coolant you're using, then obviously creating the steam, and then the steam is turning the turbine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, uranium is a very controversial element.
Yes.
Are we allowed to mess with it in terms of the international bodies? Can we also like arm ourselves in terms of have like nuclear heads? Are we allowed to do that so that we are also politically more powerful in terms of negotiations? What and because you've studied nuclear, I'm pretty sure you also kind of understand the political side of things.
Yeah.
Can we also like arm our, uranium nukes?
Okay, there are two processes that generally go into such kind of a process. If you want to arm a nuke, right, for countries that have armed nukes, they do the second process. The first process would be nuclear energy generation, which is generally safe. Unless, obviously, now you expose someone to the source itself. So it's safe for the environment. It's safe for everyone working in such a facility. When it comes to arming a nuke, this uranium-235 must go through what we call proliferation. This is just a process of enriching it. So when you enrich it, then you arm the nuke, you see. So, and this process is censured, I would call it that, because the International Atomic Agency body, their number one role is to ensure that atoms are used for peace. So we call it atomization for peace. So there is no nuclear atomization like for doing other things. You're not going into the second process to arm nukes. Or
so they follow the process.
They follow.
They have to come.
To the letter, they look at what you're doing, how you're operating. These are not things that you can hide. A reactor is a big building. So there's nothing you can hide underground from space.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
So this is what they are doing, and they ensure no other country is just coming up and doing their own thing behind the scenes, because we have to ensure that the countries that are doing this are making sure that people are safe. You know, like for when it comes to an accident, like what is happening in Fukushima or all these things that we are talking about, it affects countries, not one country. So it is the work of international bodies to ensure that people don't mess up with their nuclear, whatever they are doing, right?
Funny enough, it's because the guys who have the most nukes are the ones who are trying to tell us how not to do it.
Yeah. I think they're doing a good thing, because sometimes there are people you can't trust their intentions. We've seen of when like world wars and all that, and what you see people doing, you know. And we don't want to get into a world where you think you're so powerful so you can use a nuke. Even the countries that have nukes, and as you're saying, most of these countries that are in these bodies have nukes. They have signed MOUs of not to use them. Yeah, because exposing your enemy to such a nuke will not save you, because probably the gases will get to your country. It doesn't matter who is bombing who. The problem with a nuke is not just the death, is the repercussions to the environment. So it may expose many countries and people are sick and all that. So people are just signing MOU saying we will not use even our nukes to do our own thing.
They are forced to sign that MOU.
Yeah, they are forced because trust is quite an expensive commodity.
And talking about like the investment, I've seen guys like Bill Gates coming up with modular nuclear stations that are way smaller. What do you think about the new investments by the billionaires? Is it good for, or will they own us one day in terms of controlling the power?
Yes. I would say as a country, we've done our research very well. The problem with what is happening with the small, they're called SMRs, yeah? The small modular reactors, yeah? Mm-hmm. They are new. Everything new. Everyone is skeptical.
Yes.
Just like the industry in itself. When you introduce something new, people are skeptical. They are scared. Is it safe? Can it run for the years? You're saying it can run. What is happening with something tested, people trust it.
Mm-hmm.
So when it comes to choosing what to buy, and as I said, from generation threes to generation fours and SMRs now, you have to decide not just about the cost, but about the experience. How many years have it been in use? You can say there are no accidents. Like you see, I summarized for you how many accidents have been
there
a couple of many years, right? Yeah. When it comes to SMRs, what can we say? Maybe they've run for 5 years. What do we know? Like you can't make a conclusive argument in terms of, is it safe? Does it produce the power you need? Is it efficient? Yeah. We are talking of efficiency. Is it 50% efficient, 30% efficient? Research is still going on.
Mm-hmm.
However, there are the advantages. As you're saying, if something is smaller, the cost is also...
Of deploying, yeah.
Yes, is smaller. The exposure is also smaller. Is it safer? Yes. Most of them are very safe, theoretically.
Mm.
So such kinds of things are things that you have to decide as a country. So if you decide you're thinking just about the costs, SMRs. But if you want experience and all that, then you just opt, even if it's big and expensive, but it's tested, you're like, this thing I can depend on.
Nice. As we kind of wrap up, there's this question. Uranium or thorium? And the reason is I've seen a lot of videos on YouTube, guys trying to, you know, talk about uranium and the advantages and why it's better. From your point of view, which is thorium the right way? Just let's talk about why thorium is coming up a lot in the nuclear discussion.
Yeah.
And does it have a future?
This is a question I'll just have to be subjective. But from my experience, I think when it comes to what to exploit what you have.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have reservoirs of... or reserves of uranium, you use uranium. If you have reserves of thorium, you use thorium. However, in the world, we have 4 times more reserves of thorium than mm-hmm. uranium. So in the future, we may think of actually now going thorium
mm-hmm.
because the reserves of uranium will be depleted. You see, these are just reserves that this is not renewable.
Yes.
So... However, it will take centuries before also uranium is depleted. So we have a couple of years. The problem I have with making a decision is, again, what I talked about reactors. Reactors are already there and they're operational. If you choose a reactor that is supposed to manipulate uranium, you cannot use thorium in such a reactor.
Mm-hmm.
But then upcoming new reactors, like Generation 4 reactors, are using thorium and uranium. So they have made this accessible because they are understanding about the depletion of uranium. So thorium is therefore a way to go. And I think for me, thorium is better because when it comes to enriching thorium, and it's a chemical reaction, you will use 100%. For example, if you have your raw material of thorium, you'll use 100% of it in the reactor
mm-hmm.
because you have just to enrich it. Thorium-232 is enriched to uranium-233. And so it is taken as 100% to the reactor. But as I explained, what is happening in uranium, the uranium cake has uranium-238 and uranium-235. So you're going to take only 0.7% to the reactor. So you have a lot of mass raw material, and then you pick only 0.7% of what you can use and take it into a reactor. So generally, when you count all these things, thorium would be the way to go in future.
Let's talk about your career plans and path. And as a young lady who's into nuclear and geology, as we keep it short, because I don't want to keep you long.
This is a good question. My plans, obviously, would be to make sure, obviously, I do my PhD.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, to work in this industry for quite a long time, hoping to add value, not only to myself, but to younger people coming up. When it comes to experience in the nuclear industry, you just keep adding experience, going out for trainings, making sure you are relating closely with these bodies, these countries that are doing so much work in terms of nuclear, so that, you know, you build capacity, not only in yourself, but build capacity in other people to ensure that when it comes to operating such a plant, we are ready and we are competent.
Mm-hmm.
So my plans would be to go out for trainings, make sure I'm in the industry, be in places that I can affect change, policy making and capacity building, research and all that.
Cool, man. It was a pleasure.
Pleasure as well.
Yeah, thanks, guys, for watching. Today we were at AMP Studios. Again, if you like what we're actually doing on the show, make sure you subscribe, you share with your friends. We are planning for the next guest is from Turkana Basin Institute. We'll be talking about the Miocene Project. If you don't know what the Miocene Project, you can Google it. And then we can catch up probably in the next week or the second week after this. So it was a pleasure having you.
Yeah, the pleasure is mine.
I don't want to keep you for long. I can geek around all day.
Yeah. Pleasure is mine.
Yeah, so we were at AMP Studios. If you like what you're seeing here, also you can actually check them out on Instagram. Bye-bye. Peace.